Hey guys, thank you for joining me. I hope everyone enjoyed their weekend. Here we have a current live view of Old Faithful. People over here waiting for it to go off. I'm not doing much right now. Supposedly, according to USGS Volcano, Yellowstone activity is settling down. Doesn't look like that to me. Here's the different thumbnails for different locations around the park. We got Flag Ranch, Wyoming, Pitstone Plateau, Mary Lake, Purple Mountain, Madison River, the Promontory, Lake Butte, Borehole, 208. Looks like some of the data stopped working. Parker Peak. Yeah, some of the other monitors, they cranked up so high they don't work right. Maple Creek, etc. Here is a static camera view of Yellowstone Lake with Stevenson Island off on the right here. And that's where the majority of the earthquakes have been happening. They have listed 90 earthquakes in the last week. And as you can see, here we got an image of the lake up over here. That little spot there is Stevenson Island. Some interesting information about this area. Over here we got Dot Island. There is three different areas there at Yellowstone Lake where they have an area of hydrothermal vents. We got one here close to where that 3.6 earthquake happened over by Dot Island, another hydrothermal area, and then up here by Stevenson Island, another hydrothermal vent field. The temperature there down there at the bottom of the lake, which is about 390 feet deep. This is the deepest area of the lake. The temperature down there is anywhere between 340 to 350 degrees. The red line drawn out is part of the fault system. Over here you can see Dot Island. That's an area where there's a crack at the bottom of the lake where there's spreading going on, where the rhyolite, the magma, is trying to come up. Another interesting fact is that the ice age actually didn't end not too long ago, about 13,000 years ago. After the ice age, the trees grew up. There was no trees before then. And do you realize that these trees, and they have fossilized trees there at Yellowstone, but they didn't start to grow until about 11,000 years ago. And these trees were covered in ash and then became fossils. So if there was no trees growing there at Yellowstone 11,000 years ago, and they grew up, and then there was a volcanic eruption. Now the last major eruption was, 635,000 years ago. But there was no trees then. So what volcanic eruption made these trees become buried in the ash and turn to fossils less than 11,000 years ago? Now, there was evidently 27 different eruptions. There's 27 different layers of fossilized forests, each stacked one atop the other, layer by layer, to a thickness of 1,200 feet. One scientist said the Ascorpa volcanism lasted for 15 million years. In that time, there was alternating periods of activity and dormancy. The active periods caused the trees become encased and eventually fossilized. During the ensuing dormancy, new trees grew up on top of the old, only to be encased in the volcanic activity. But core samples taken there at Yellowstone Lake in 2018 did a study of pollen, and it showed that there was no trees growing before 11,000 years ago. The early evolution of southern Yellowstonias occurred in the first 4,000 years following the ice recession and the subsequent stability of the South Yellowstone morphology. In the last 10,000 years occurred during a period of pine dominated forests and relative warm conditions, which all happened after the ice age. And I will give you a link to this document showing how, yeah, the data does not add up. Does not add up at all. Ice recession and the climate warming began 15,000 years ago, initiating a sequence of events that has led to the present day ecosystem. The pollen record suggested that early vegetation of tundra and sapuline vegetation indicating cold conditions, followed by a transition of large pole pine forest about 11,000 years ago in response to warming. So 27 layers of ash killing off the forest, which regrew 27 times. Someone's not telling us the whole truth about how many eruptions were at Yellowstone and within what time frame and how large they were. Here we have an image of all the earthquakes that have occurred probably within the last, 24 hours, maybe a little bit more, there at Yellowstone Lake, the promontory. And I'll bring it down to when I just pulled the files, maybe a half an hour ago, and it's currently almost 6:30 p.m. Central Daylight Time. I would definitely say it's too early to say if it's settling down or not. This earthquake here at 22:30 Universal Time would be at 5:30 p.m. Central Daylight Time. Comes in as a magnitude 2.3, and they're not reporting it. USGS has only one earthquake listed for the day, a magnitude 3.2 that occurred there near Stanley, Idaho, which is near the Sawtooth. That is it for the day. And you can see for yourself with your own eyes, there has been lots of earthquakes, many marked in red, which means it was at or close to the location of this monitor and sent a text message to the geologist, either there at Menlo Park or at the University of Utah. So there's that one there. And then we got another one here. I'm just going to go through the most recent. You can see the line of melt here, and I've talked about that before. There's its signature, and they've been having some very long earthquakes starting last night, and I posted that on Twitter. I'll show you that one in a minute. This one here is a magnitude 2.73, and what's concerning is how long it's lasting and the type of earthquakes, which is volcanic and harmonic tremors. You often see this prior to, during, and after a volcanic eruption. I want to jump up over here where this earthquake occurred that I posted on Twitter. I mean, look at this. Okay, so we got 51 minutes and 50 seconds after midnight when this earthquake started happening. So that would be 7:51 p.m. yesterday. And let me pull this over so you can look at the signature. How I found this was I was going to try and break down this earthquake and see what the magnitude was. Let me show you the spectrogram. I mean, it's like, wow. Okay, let me bring it back over. Oh. Yeah, look at that. And we'll go back to its signature. This earthquake lasted for about 6 minutes. Oh, sorry, brought it off the line. 6 minutes, right there in that section alone. The best estimate I could come up with was that this was a magnitude 3 that USGS never reported. And they had the nerve to say that Yellowstone was settling down. So the next one in this line in red is right there at 19:17. So that would be 2:17 p.m. Central Daylight Time. We'll go to the signature right there. And that one comes in as a magnitude 2.49. All right, we got another fairly large one right there. Let's look at its signature or the spectrogram at about 18:10 Universal Time. So that would be 1:10 p.m. Central Daylight Time. And again, a very long signature, harmonic tremors. And that comes in as a magnitude 2.53. At about 11:01 Central Daylight Time or 16:01 Universal Time, we had a series of drum beats. See that? And I'll try and keep it on the line there. Now, what is the significance of drum beats? A change in the frequency of earthquakes may foretell explosive volcanic eruptions, according to studies. The seismic activity changes from steady drum beats to increasingly rapid succession of tremors. These blend into a continuous noise, that whistle that I talk about, which silences just before an explosion. 15:46 Universal Time. More drum beats. Oops, excuse me. And we'll go to its signature. You can look at this chart and see all the drum beats that were occurring. Let me pull this up for you. 8:10. Boom, 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 boom. See how fast they're coming in? We got 8:11, 8:12, another one at 8:12. Yeah. 8:12 and 35 seconds, 8:12 and 55 seconds. 10:18 and 40 seconds, 10:18 and 55 seconds. Let's see, 10:19 and 20 seconds. I mean, look at them all. 15:46 and 15 seconds, 25 seconds, and 35 seconds. Yeah, we got more here and they're even smaller. Let me close this and see if I can get them to show up on here. There we go. 15:54 and 10 seconds, 30 seconds, 40 seconds, 10 seconds, 55 seconds, or 15:55 and 25 seconds. And there's more over here. And this is what it was showing when I pulled the files. Okay. For some reason, I have to sometimes close this and reopen it to get it to work right, where it will actually show you the signatures. Yeah, I would not say it's settling down. It might be. We'll give it another 24 hours and see. The tilt meter for Yellowstone Lake. This is where all the earthquakes have been occurring. Top measures north. They're measuring what direction the magma is flowing under the ground. And the earthquakes started between the 16th and 17th, and we can see that it took a drop in one direction, and the bottom is east, and yeah, we can see this zigzag pattern that it's been doing for the last 7 days, and then we'll go back to the last 30 days, and we can see that the magma is flowing east under the ground. I've talked about this over and over. One of the boreholes for the Norris Geyser Basin, borehole 205, and again, this is a very deep well dug under the ground. Oh, probably about 500 to 600 feet under the ground. Top is north, bottom is east. You see, it took a breath here between the 14th and 15th. This is the last 7 days, and you can see how the magma is spreading out. Each dot would be an earthquake that affected the tilt meter in some way, either going up or down. And we'll go back to the last 30 days. Now they got this set at 5 microradians. And then this one, they have set at 1 microradian, so it's going to show the spreading more. You might find this interesting, borehole 950. Again, Norris Geyser Basin. Top is north, bottom is east. Look how it's been going up and down, up and down. And they'll say, oh yeah, it does that all the time. Yeah, it does. When the ground is breathing from magma. This chart here goes back to 2014. A borehole 207 for Madison River. Yeah, up and down, up and down. Look at that for the last week. And the magma is changing direction. Look at that. If X is north and Y is east. Yeah, look at that. And then for the last 30 days, two breaths it took there. I have three different monitors. The top one here is Norris Geyser Basin, Little West Thumb, and the Promontory. Little West Thumb, that is a time period where the magma came in so loud that it went quiet. Okay, and we got that earthquake that I recently showed you. Shows up on all three monitors, and they did not report it. And then we got another little one here. It shows up barely at Norris Geyser, but it's also on all three monitors. And we'll go back another 4 hours. There we go. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 that are on Norris Geyser that also show up on all three monitors, and they're not reporting them. This program here is from IRIS, and it's also used and in collusion with USGS. The other software program that I'm using is also IRIS, but also for USGS. That's the one that shows you the spectrogram. Now, another thing that is concerning is when the water level gets low, which I can tell by looking at the river. I don't know if I can make that bigger for you. That's as large as I can make it. But what's concerning is as the water level gets low, the less pressure, and there's more of a chance of a hydrothermal eruption. And with the three different areas of hydrothermal vents, one of them off in the distance from Stevenson Island, less pressure holding down. Will we have a hydrothermal eruption? Will we have another tsunami? It's hard to say. We definitely do not want another major eruption, but the whole fact about the trees has me wondering. 27 levels of trees covered in ash, petrified, and regrew within the last 10,000 years. Where did that 1,000 feet of ash come from? So what are your thoughts? Please put your comments down below. Thank you very much for watching. Thank you very much for your support. Always be prepared for a disaster. Please stay safe, and I'll talk to you later. God bless y'all.